So in this session, we are going to talk about the basic human aspiration and its fulfillment. So we all have aspirations, right? We are having so many goals, targets, objectives in life. So in this session, we are going to explore the basic aspiration that we have, which is guiding all these goals and programs, you know. And also we'll try to look at the fulfillment part of it, that if the goal is clear to us, the basic human aspiration is clear to us, then what could be the process of its fulfillment? Second thing that we are going to discuss in this session is regarding holistic development. So development is such a word that we keep on using almost every day. And as a nation, we want to develop, as a society, we want to develop, as a family, we want to develop, right? So what is the meaning of development? And when can this development be termed as holistic? And again, since we all are involved in education, so we need to find out our role, the role of education in this holistic development. So we'll discuss all this in this session, and we are just going to there will no prescription as such, right? Only thing that we'll start a dialogue with you on this issue. So as we discussed in the previous session, we need a human education sanskar in the society, which would develop a human worldview, a human perspective in the child, right? And on the basis of such a perspective only, the child can contemplate the human values, the values living with which, you know, his basic aspiration can be fulfilled, so that he is able to decide for himself or what skills would be conducive for living with human conduct, so that the child can become a foundation of the human society. And we also discussed about the basic guidelines. So these basic guidelines are very important, as Professor Rajnish Arora elaborated on them, that whatever we discuss in terms of human values have to obey certain guidelines. Like one thing is there, they have to be universal. They have to be rational also. There need not be any prescription of do's and don'ts. And we saw that there's a difference between moral value and, you know, human value. So when you prescribe something to the other in terms of do's and don'ts, should and shouldn't, it becomes a kind of dictum or dogma or belief, right? But when the student is allowed to, you know, apply one's logic, rationality, and then understand, then it becomes a part of the understanding. Thirdly, we talked about the verifiability, that whatever is being said, you know, has to be verifiable. So we'll see that in the whole discussion that we are going to have now, we'll try to verify everything. So at times we'll pose some questions to you for you to reflect upon, right? And we'll go by those reflections. We'll try to understand your reflections, and we'll see that ultimately, if you have to understand things, we have to look within, we have to explore within, we have to self-explore, so that we are able to come up with very genuine answers. And since these questions that we are going to pose are related to very basic issues of our life, we can see how naturally we are able to respond to them. And fourthly, as it was mentioned, it has to lead to harmony. Now, when we have the understanding of these values, then our education can be, the skill education can be value guided, so that it becomes a pillar of the just and equitable society. So we'll talk about these issues: basic human aspiration, the fulfillment of it, holistic development, and the role of education in it. And this will also give us an idea about the content of this whole program, the 5-day online workshop that we are going to have, the process of this workshop, and the expected achievement from this kind of input. So in the very beginning, let me mention, as we briefly mentioned earlier also, that whatever is being said here is a proposal. Right? And proposal means we don't have to start by assuming it as true or false. There may be some proposal which matches your pre-assumptions, and you may assume the proposal to be true, or it may contradict your assumptions and you may assume the proposal to be wrong. But that is not going to take us anywhere. Ultimately, what is going to lead us to a state of understanding would be a verification on our own right. Now, when you go to verify, again, verification and comparing are two different things. When you verify, then there is something called natural acceptance, which is there in each one of us. And when we refer to our natural acceptance, we get very genuine answers. Comparing would mean that you have heard something earlier, read something earlier, right? And you are just comparing what is being said here to something that you have read earlier. But that will again not be verification. And that will also only be a match or mismatch of our earlier conditionings or presuppositions. So what is basically expected in this session is to verify the proposals. And I hope all of us are in agreement on this, right? So let me ask you one question, a very simple question. what is naturally acceptable to you, the feeling of relationship or the feeling of opposition, right? And just try to respond to this within yourself, and you'll see that what comes naturally to you is the feeling of relationship and not opposition. Now just find out, from where did you get this answer? Has this been taught to you, you know? Has this been something as a part of your reading, right? Or something like this, or simply it is very much innate to you. It is very much intrinsic to you, you know, very basic to you. So you'll see that each one of us naturally accepts to have a feeling of relationship and not of opposition. But when you look at your living, you can see that you may be living with a lot of opposition, right? Here and there, in the family, in the organization, in the society. But again, it is not acceptable to us naturally. So what we are going to do, if you look at this complete workshop, this is just a reference to our natural acceptance. And the more we are able to refer these proposals to our natural acceptance, more genuine answers we are able to get. And then we have a confidence within ourselves that, yes, what I'm thinking is right, what I'm doing is right. You know? I'm not dependent on any outside source to evaluate myself, but rather on the basis of this verification, I can evaluate myself. You know? So it is a process of dialogue. So a dialogue between me and you to start with, but it soon becomes a dialogue within your own self. So I'm proposing certain things from my side. Now with the limitation of this online workshop, we may not be able to listen to every participant's observation. So what we can do, we'll be launching some polls here to get your reflection. And through that, we can have your opinion on these issues. But the basic purpose is to initiate a process of dialogue. Now, when we have those offline 3 days and 8 days workshops, then we are in real conversation, you know, with the participants. And then we are able to listen to everybody's opinion on every issue. And then we are able to go ahead with the exploration. So you'll see that in this workshop, a dialogue gets started between me and you, but soon it will become a dialogue within your own self. So if you look at yourself, you keep talking to yourself, isn't it? If you just ask yourself, who is the person on this earth to whom you talk the most? What do you think? You will see it is yourself. You keep talking to yourself almost all the time, right? So we are talking to ourselves, right? But we have to address two distinct realities within us. One is what you are, right? So your living part, your thoughts, your desires, your expectations as they are today, you know, your goals, objectives that you have set, your plans and programs, your interactions with your neighbor, with your colleague, you know, whatever, as you are living. And the second reality that is associated with you is what you really want to be, your natural acceptance. Now, when you try to refer to them, you will find that the two are not the same. As we mentioned earlier, that what is naturally acceptable is the feeling of relationship. But when you look at the living part, you can see that there may be oppositions involved, right? So what I am may not be the same as what I really want to be. And you will also see that there may be a vast gap between what you are and what you really want to be, right? So do you think there is a need to initiate this kind of dialogue? Generally, what we do, we keep on, you know, involving ourselves in discussions only within the realm of what I am, you know, right? But when we are able to address this particular reality also, what you really want to be, then the dialogue, you know, becomes more substantiated, becomes more, you know, genuine, more involving with your real life issues. So you'll try to establish this dialogue, you know, and you see that this happens very naturally. So the purpose of this workshop is to initiate this internal dialogue. And I hope all of us, you know, are able to see that this dialogue is very important for each one of us. Now let me start by asking a few questions. So do we want to be happy? Do we want to be prosperous? And do we want the continuity of happiness and prosperity? Right. So start thinking about it. Let me ask this. So you can share your views here, you know. So do you want to be happy? Whatever meaning you might have associated with happiness, whatever meaning you might have associated with prosperity, you know, with that, meaning that you have associated for yourself, you know, do you want to have it or not, one thing, and do you want to have the continuity of it? So keep on asking this. So there is a symbol that will keep on floating almost in every session, you know, that you have to pause and think, pause and reflect upon your own, you know, self, the way you look at the questions that are being posed here. In the meantime, I can see one hand raised. So Dr. Satish Kumar, any question pertaining to this particular topic that we are discussing? Okay, fine. Nice. So almost all of you are able to see, like regarding happiness, everybody has said 100%, you know, that I want to be happy. Regarding prosperity, there is some opinion. Yeah, nice. So that means that we may have different connotations of prosperity, and we'll look into the meaning of prosperity also. But most of you are able to see that, yes, you want to be prosperous. And again, most of you are able to see that you want to have the continuity. Some of you are have the opinion that you don't want to have the continuity. Now, there are so many prevalent notions. Like one notion is that if you are happy in continuity, then you will not understand what is happiness, you know, or you will not be able to do certain duties. So many things. But again, even if these thoughts occur to you, just reflect on this and ask yourself, given all these thoughts, ultimately, what is naturally acceptable? If you ever feel that you want to be unhappy, you know, just note that moment and do this exercise. In a day, whenever you feel that you want to be happy, unhappy, just note that time. And we'll say that there is no moment when you say that you want to be unhappy. Ultimately, you want to be happy. You might have different notions about happiness. So we'll understand what happiness is, what prosperity is. Now, let me ask another thing. So earlier, we were talking about what we really want to be, something our natural acceptance. Now, here, we have to reflect upon our state of being. Okay. So we are able to see clearly. Everybody said that you want to be happy, right? Now, are we happy? What response do we get? We said that you want to be prosperous. Are we prosperous? And is there continuity of the two? So continuity means every moment. Every moment would mean, you know, all the moments in a day, all the moments in a week, all the moments in a year. So what is our state of being? Let me ask again, have your opinion on this. So is there continuity of our happiness and prosperity? We are asking about the continuity part. If you are sometimes happy, sometimes unhappy, sometimes happy, most of the time unhappy, most of the time happy, sometimes unhappy, still there is no continuity. So when we say continuity, that essentially means that it is there very much every moment. So reflect on this. Now, what we are trying to do, we are trying to, you know, look within. We are trying to look at ourselves. We got a message on the WhatsApp some days back that if you can't go outside, go inside, right? So this lockdown has given us ample opportunity to go inside, to reflect upon ourselves, to reflect on our state of being, what we are, and also to look at our natural acceptance, what we really want to be. Nice. So some people are saying that yes, there is continuity, you know, but some people are saying that no, there is no continuity. So again, keep on reflecting on this. So continuity, as I explained, means that are you able to see that you are happy every moment, right? Not a single moment of anguish, you know, or anxiety or depression or, you know, unhappiness or opposition or whatever, something that is not acceptable to you naturally. If there is any moment that you are going through, then it means that you are not happy in that moment. You know? So just reflect on this. Keep on reflecting. Okay. So why this gap? Here we could say that all of us want to be happy in continuity, right? Or at least we want to be happy, and some were also able to, many of us were able to see that we want to have the continuity of happiness and prosperity. But when it comes to evaluating our state of being, we are able to see that it's not there. There is no continuity, right? So there is a gap between our desire and our state of being, between what we really want to be and what we are, isn't it? So there is a gap. And if you look at this gap is essentially the problem in our life. If you are not the way you really want to be, you are in problems. If you are the way you really want to be, then you are resolved. You don't have problem, isn't it? So if you look at this, the whole problem in our life is this particular gap. So what are we doing to fill this gap? Do we have any substantial program to fill this gap? And just find out over time, is this gap getting wider or getting filled up? And I reflect upon this with time. In early childhood, how was this gap? Then we became a youth. How was this gap? And today, if you see, what is the condition of this gap? See, this gap getting wider or getting filled up? So we'll explore into this, right? Now just find out something that is written on the right hand side. Is our effort for the continuity of happiness and prosperity, or it is just for accumulation of physical facilities? Now let me explain what does this mean. So physical facilities, all the physiochemical things that we can see. And presently in the current economic system, we are getting all these facilities through money. So if you are just working for accumulation of physical facility, right? So accumulating more and more of the things that we have as assets in our family, in our house, right? So this is working just for accumulation of physical facility, or loosely saying, just for accumulating money, accumulating wealth. Is it so, or we are really able to work for continuity of happiness and prosperity? So just find out, when you are there with your family, what is the content of your talk? Is it something about your happiness? And are you able to ask the other, are you happy living with me? Are you able to share, are you happy living with the other? Do you talk about happiness? Do you make some program the next day to ensure happiness of the other? Or mostly we are talking about our investments, the economic scenario, this lockdown, the how the stock exchange is going down, how the share market is going down, what you have to do next day, where do you have to invest, how to earn more. Now, if this is the way, then we are just focused on accumulation of physical facility. The other way could be, we are able to address the need for happiness very clearly. We are having a direct program for happiness and prosperity. So just find out. Again, I'd like to have your opinion on this. Try to share this. So is our effort, I explain what I mean to say, right? So for continuity of happiness and prosperity would mean that we are able to make a direct program for the happiness of yourself, of the other, And accumulation would mean that you are mostly focused on accumulating physical facility. And see, if you are also feeling that through physical facility, you are going to be happy, and that's why you are working for physical facility, ultimately your effort is for physical facility. Isn't it? So if you feel that today your bank balance is, let us say, X amount, and if it becomes X plus delta, you are going to be happier. So you are going to work on that economic front. So you may assume that you are working for your happiness, but ultimately you are working for accumulation of physical facility. And we'll explore into this, that is happiness directly related to physical facility, or there are some more important things in life? That is something that we are going to explore in this session. Right. And another thing, we need to make a very sincere evaluation of ourselves. Right. This is a very sincere evaluation, and the opinion that you give, right, is not going to be shared by anybody else participating in the workshop. So we have to make a very sincere evaluation, observation about ourselves. Okay, nice. So, okay, it's very pleasing to see that most of you are saying that you are working for the continuity of happiness and prosperity. But again, I'll say that, try to refer back to this, try to explore more into this, and just find out whether your effort is going directly for physical facility or accumulation of physical facility, or is it directly focused on the happiness issue, the prosperity issue, right? Nice. So just find out, have we assumed that happiness and prosperity will be ensured when we have enough physical facility? Have you assumed this? Again, think over it. Pause a little bit and think over it. That is there something like this in your assumption? That today you have X amount, if it becomes 2X, you know, then you are going to be, you know, naturally very happy, right? Have you come to assume this? And if not, then what effort are we making other than accumulation of physical facility? Try to find out, how do we spend our time in a day, right from morning till night? You know, how do we plan our day? Just think over it. And also try to reflect on this, that have we come to assume that happiness and prosperity will be automatically ensured when we have enough physical facility? Isn't it? Do you think these issues are important? What do you think? They are very much important. Now, let us have some evaluation about physical facility. So we'll see that when an animal has lack of physical facility, it becomes uncomfortable. When it gets physical facility, it becomes comfortable. For example, when a cow gets a stomach full of grass, it becomes comfortable, sits and chews the cud, isn't it? So if you have a cow in the house, you provide fodder twice a day, water thrice a day, provide a shade, right? And the cow is very much comfortable. Every time you go to the cow, you know, the cow will respond in a particular manner because you are providing the physical facility to the cow and the cow is comfortable with this. Now, what happens with a human being? If you try to provide the same thing with your child, to your child, right? Do you think that is going to suffice? Do you think that is going to be enough? If you just provide food to your child, clothes to your child, there is a house in which the child is residing, right? Do you think this is going to be enough? The child will simply sit quietly and, you know, respond the same way the cow is responding. So certainly not. In fact, when a human being has lack of physical facility, he becomes uncomfortable and unhappy. But once he gets the physical facility, he forgets about it and starts thinking about 100 other things. So if you look at your child, you know, you are providing food, clothes, shelter to the child, but the child needs your affection. Right? The child needs your care. The child needs to share with you. So many things. So one thing is there, that the needs of a child are not just physical facilities. Right? Second thing you can observe, that once we have the physical facility, we simply forget about it and start thinking about 100 other things. For example, if you do not have a house of your own today, you know, every day you think about owning a house, from where to get loan, how to manage the funds, right? What to sell off, you know, how to, where to purchase the house, and so many things keep on moving in your thoughts. And we'll see that sometime back, you might not have a house of your own. Today, you have a house of your own and you simply forget about it. And you start thinking about something else. Now the house is there, but the drawing room looks very, you know, odd. So you want to, you know, decorate your drawing room. Next day you have this drawing room decorated, but your the house is there, the drawing room is there, but you don't have a car of your own. So why not own a car? So you go for purchasing a car, right? Now the next day you have a car also with a house, you know, luxurious house. But again, you start thinking about something more, right? The house, this car has become something of like an old model. You know, why not go for a new brand car? So you'll see that, you know, once we do not have the physical facility, we simply keep on thinking about it. But if we have the physical facility, we start, we simply forget it and start thinking about so many other things. Now check for yourself if you feel happy every day that you are getting enough to eat. So if you do not get your breakfast someday, it becomes a matter of turmoil in the family, you know, something awkward may take place in the family. But if you are getting enough to eat every day, you simply forget it. Let me ask you another question through this self-reflection.
There is one hand raised.
Okay, Bhaiya.
Jeeva Malar J.
Yes, sir. Dr. Jeeva Malar, you can unmute and speak, sir. Okay, I think I'm not able to reach him, bhaiya.
Malar, are you able to hear? You raised your hand.
It's okay. There, then he'll be able to respond. So at appropriate points, you can just take. Please go ahead.
Dr. Rajesh is there. Any pertinent question to this particular discussion? Fine, sir. Fine. So just raise your hands. From time to time, we'll keep on addressing you in person. Now let me ask another question here. Now think about it. So the symbol says pause and think. Are you aware how many pairs of clothes you have? When did you count your clothes last? Just think about it. Or have you ever counted your clothes? And counting would mean taking into account all the clothes that you have. Now say if you have to go to a party, right? And you feel that you do not have a cloth, or you feel that you need some kind of exotic dress to go to the party, and you start thinking of purchasing the new kind of cloth. But are you really aware what kind of cloth you have already in the house, in your trunk, in your wardrobe? So I'm just asking that, are we really aware how many pairs of clothes we have? Okay. If somebody wants to say something. Dr. Velumani. Dr. Uma Maheshwari.
Yes, sir. I am Dr. Velumani here.
Hello, ma'am.
Yeah, I did count the clothes so far. During the lockdown, I wanted to do, but I was engaged with some official work. Definitely, I'll do it.
Okay, okay. Nice, ma'am. So one task that we are going to give you today is to count your clothes. So today evening when we meet, come with the count of your clothes. We are going to ask you, right? What I have done for myself, I have made an Excel sheet, and that Excel sheet I keep on updating the record of my clothes. So we need to be aware how many clothes we have, right? Before we go to purchase a cloth, we have to be aware how many do we have already in the house. In fact, in the workshop, we have found that once we give this assignment, many people come with a sharing that they were not even aware of so many pairs of clothes that they already have, right? It was gifted some time back by the in-laws, by some friend on some occasion. They kept it in the box and they simply forgot it, right? Nice.
Sir, I have a question. I'm Uma Maheshwari.
Yes, ma'am.
Sir, you are saying about comfort and how it is going to take to happiness. But comfort is different from satisfaction. It's my point of view. So only when you are satisfied, you'll be happy. Yeah, being comfort may not be happy, right? It is
certainly,
only...
This is what we are also saying, that physical facility will not suffice for happiness.
Yes.
But we have to come to a conclusion with proper exploration. So I'm not saying that this comfort is going to make you happy. We are just saying that if you do not have some comfort today, you keep on thinking about that comfort. Tomorrow, when you have that comfort, you simply forget about it and start thinking about so many other things which can give you comfort.
Exactly. So once you got one thing, you will expect another thing. That is human tendency, right? Yeah. Yes, sir. Thank you.
Keep on doing. Yeah.
Okay, yes, sir. Thank you.
Hello.
Hello.
Sir, I have a question.
Yes, ma'am.
I'm Sita Lakshmi, chairperson of Faculty of Architecture and Planning in Anna University.
Yes.
Different people all over the world are in different states of desire and fulfillment of that. So this imbalance starts, becoming a problem. Also, the other thing is that sometimes we also have to be in a place where, like, we are disturbed by things in order for us to change things. So in that sense, happiness sometimes is also a liability, because it makes us accept everything. That is one thing. The other thing is that certain things which we cannot control, like health and all that, which are the things which we accept and which are the things which we put effort towards to improve, that I think is the dilemma of human existence. Which we can improve, which we cannot, is actually it's a difficult thing. So I would want to know your views on that.
Certainly, ma'am. This whole workshop is going to talk about it, about happiness and the contradictions and dilemmas that we have with lack of right understanding of happiness. We are going to discuss all this in detail, ma'am.
Okay.
So nice. It's just 50-50. Half of the people say that, you know, they are aware, and half of the people say that they are not aware. Very nice. So those who say that they are not aware, you know, need to become aware. And those who say that they are aware, right, I'll just request that they really need to look into it and find out. If they are completely aware, well and good. You know, then you can also see whether you have more than required or not. You know, you can just try to find out whether the clothes that we have, are they more than required or not. So, as we discussed earlier, you know, that so many, you know, different things keep on occurring to us, and we simply forget about what we have already, right? So, something more is required over and above the physical facility. So, physical facility is necessary for human being, but something more is also required. So, what is that more? That we'll try to find out. Not just find out. Is the unhappiness in our families more due to lack of physical facility or more due to lack of fulfillment in the relationships? So what does this mean? So there could be unhappiness in the family, you know, due to physical facility also. There could be unhappiness in the family due to lack of fulfillment of relationship also. But we are asking, what is the major reason, right? What is the major reason? So try to find it out. First of all, you know, try to find out whether there is unhappiness in the family or not. And it may be there. It may be there. You know, there is nothing wrong about it, I am saying. It may be there, but we have to find out, you know, what is the major reason about it, major reason for it. So again, reflect upon this. So the unhappiness in your family, is it more due to lack of physical facility or more due to lack of fulfillment in the relationship? We are talking about the major reason, right? Let me also give another clarification here, that even if it may occur to you sometime that the problems are more due to lack of, you know, physical facility, then just try to think over it. Let us say a very crude example I'm giving. There are four people in a family and every member requires 5 chapatis in a day. Chapati is something that we eat in the north. We can equate it to something, you know, that we eat in the south, maybe idlis. So every person requires, you know, 5 idlis in a day, right? So the family requires 20 idlis in a day. And let us say someday there are only 18 idlis, 2 idlis are less. So will there be a fight in the family or not? What do you think? So if there is a feeling of relationship in the family, you know, you will feed the other first and then eat, isn't it? If you have that feeling of relationship. But if there is no feeling of relationship, then you will snatch from the other, right? And also accumulate for the next day, because if tomorrow also the same scenario appears, then what to do? So you'll try to accumulate for the next day. And if you look at the state of the families, you know, this is something that is happening. If you look at the family feuds, you know, if you try to find out how much assets they have in the family, you can be able to see that the assets are not less, but only that there is a lack of relationship, and that's why there is so much of feud there. So nice, you are able to see that the problems are more due to lack of fulfillment in the relationships. Okay. So this is something that we are going to address. Then how to, you know, ensure the fulfillment of relationship. So once you are able to see that the problems are not more due to lack of physical facility, but more due to lack of this fulfillment of the relationship part, right? Then we'll make a direct program for addressing this issue. And just find out how much time and effort we are investing for physical facility and how much time and effort we are investing for the fulfillment in relationship. This is again for us to explore, right? So again, let me elaborate on this. So we saw that the problems are more due to lack of fulfillment in relationship. So we want to mend our relationship. We want to make them better. But if you feel that your relationship is going to be good only when you have this kind of physical facility, right? For example, there is one TV in the house, and every person has a desire to watch the channel of his or her own choice, right? And there is a quarrel in the family for television. So what do you think now? You think that if everybody had a television of one's own, then this quarrel would not take place. So again, you feel that a quarrel should not happen in the family. So for that, you have to earn more so that you can ensure one television set for every family member. And then you go to earn more facility for this, go to earn more money for this. So you may feel that you are working for the fulfillment in relationship. But ultimately, if you see, you are investing yourself for the physical facility. If there is a feeling of relationship, the same television set, the single television set, can be observed by all sitting together. You can offer to the other that, okay, you observe your channel, I will observe your channel, right? The other may also say that, no, you observe your channel, I will observe your channel. So this also could be one way. And there could be another scenario. The other scenario is we do not need to watch the television when we are together. We need to talk to each other. We need to sit with each other. So you have to reflect that even if you feel concerned for relationship, are you going to directly make a program for the relationship by understanding each other, by sharing with each other, by knowing each other's thoughts and feelings, right? The unhappiness or unhappiness in the other. Are we investing our time and effort for this part, or assuming that only physical facilities will bring down this kind of turmoil in the family, this kind of aggressiveness in the other, then you try to ensure the physical facility. So you'll see that in the name of relationship also, indirectly, you might be working for physical facility. So the question that we are going to ask now is this particular thing. And then the way I elaborated, kindly try to reflect on that. So where are you investing most of the time and effort? For fulfillment in relationship or for physical facility? As I explained, no. So you may assume that you are working for relationship, but if you're working directly for physical facility only, indirectly relating the physical facility to the relationship, then you are simply working for physical facility, assuming that this will fetch good relationships in the family. For example, the parents may feel that for their child, they have to ensure a good future, right? And for that, they have to earn a lot of money. So they are investing themselves day and night. Husband and wife both are investing day and night, working to accumulate wealth in the family so that the future of the child can be bright, right? But ultimately, if you see, you are working for physical facility, assuming that you are working for relationship. And if you ask the child, what is more required on the part of the child? Sharing of time with you, sharing of feelings with you, or both the husband and wife getting involved only in their earning of wealth and ignoring the child and just trying to accumulate the physical facility for the child. So try to address this particular part. If you just try to articulate how much time in a day we are investing for the relationship, how much time in a day we are sitting together, sharing with each other, trying to understand each other, right? Whenever we commit a mistake, try to apologize to the other, try to share with the other what made you commit the mistake, right? Most of the time in the family, we'll see that we are not interacting for fulfillment in relationship, but we are interacting due to lack of fulfillment in the relationship, saying some awkward words to the other, and then the other also shouting back at us, right? And then avoiding to talk for days together. And these kinds of things are happening, right? Nurturing grudges, complaints in ourselves about the other, So nice, many of you are able to see that the most of the time and effort is being spent for physical facility and not for fulfillment in the relationship. While if you see, the problems are due to lack of fulfillment of relationship, majorly, but the major effort is going for physical facility. So the problem is somewhere else and we are trying to look for solution somewhere else, right? In fact, there is a joke about a professor that one night he was looking for his ring below a street light. So whoever passed by asked the professor that what happened, and he said that, oh, my ring has got lost here, and so I'm looking for it. So whoever passed by started helping him out, and about 1 hour had passed, and then one person simply got amazed and asked that, are you really sure that the ring has fallen here below the street light? He said, no, this ring has fallen outside in the pond, right? Then he asked that, why are you looking for the ring here below the street light? Then he said that, because there is light here, the pond is dark, I can't look for my ring there, so I'm looking for my ring here. Now, what does this mean? This means that we all are trained through education to work for physical facility. If you just look at the curriculum and the syllabus since childhood, it was mainly focused on physical facility. If you look at the major content of the courses that we are studying and teaching, it is mainly focused on physical facility, right? And we all are suffering in relationships. So you can see that education is not able to directly address our need. So education is spreading. If you look at the literacy, it has gone up. In fact, in Kerala and Tamil Nadu, it is a very good percentage. I think it is nearing 100, isn't it? So the literacy has gone so high in the past 50 years. At the same time, you can see the problems in families have also gone up. You just see, if in a family only husband is earning and wife is not earning, then there is one kind of state in the family. If husband and wife both are earning, then the physical facilities have gone up in the family. But just think, if the husband and wife do not have a feeling of relationship and they are competing with each other to earn more and more, right? Or trying to show off to the other with a lack of fulfillment in the relationship. Now, what kind of a state would be there? Will there be happiness in the family, or there will be unhappiness in the family, right? So there will be unhappiness in the family. So the literacy has gone up, so-called education has also gone up. At the same time, the problems in relationship have also gone up. The physical facilities have also gone up. If you just look at the state of society 30 years back, there were hardly few houses which had this color television. In fact, 40 years back, there was hardly any house which had this black and white TV. 30 years back, there were hardly any houses which had color television sets. And if you look 20 years back, there were only few hands which had mobile phones. And today everybody has a smartphone. So if you can see, the communication channels have gone so up, so high, right? But if you look at the communication, is the communication today more with a feeling of relationship as it was earlier? If you try to look at the quality of communication that is taking place today, it is not that way. It has not gone up in a similar manner. Many a times you will see that it has gone down, right? The quality of communication. We just think, if in a family there is only one television set, let us say start from the first situation. There's a family in which there is no television set. There's a family in which there is one television set. And there's a family in which every person has a television set of his own. Now just find out, where will the communication be highest? So you can see that if the house does not have any television set, people will spend time together. Maybe if they do not have a feeling of relationship, they will fight with each other, but at least the communication would be there. If there is one television set, then people will sit in front of the television and talk about what is being shown in the television, but not about each other. And when every person has a television set of his own, then they will not talk at all, right? Now this mobile, if you see, is doing something similar. Every person is involved in his or her own mobile, right? And seldom interacting with the other. So we have to find out how much time and effort we are investing for physical facility and how much time and effort we are investing for the fulfillment in the relationship. So you can see that the unhappiness is more due to lack of fulfillment in relationship, but most of the time and effort is spent for physical facility. So we can make out one thing very clearly, that for human being, relationship is also necessary. Physical facility is necessary. If we are communicating with each other, then we are utilizing our mobile phone or computers or gadgets, right? But again, at the same time, the way we are communicating, that can only happen with a feeling of relationship. So for human being, physical facility is necessary, but relationship is also necessary. And on examining carefully, we can find that this is a fundamental difference between animals and human being. Physical facility is necessary for animals and necessary for human being also, right? But one observation that you can make is, for animals, physical facility is necessary as well as adequate. An animal can survive simply by physical facility, right? But for human being, it is necessary but not adequate. Now, if you look at the jail, we call it as a punishment. Why? Because you are deprived of your relationships there. You can't be with your family, with your friends. You cannot interact with people outside, right? You are given all the physical facilities. You are provided shelter, you are provided food, you are provided clothes. Now you do the same thing for an animal, it may be comfortable. And if you feel that the animal also requires, to be together, our need for relationship is much deeper, much wider, much more than that of an animal. An animal never thinks of building up the career of his child, right? And we think so much. We invest our life to build up the career of our child because we are concerned about the child. For ourselves, you can see that physical facility is necessary but not adequate for sure. It may be adequate for the animals. So for human beings, physical facility is necessary, but relationship is also necessary. This is something that we can see. So there are two blocks here. One has written, one has relationship. This is mentioned there, relationship with human being. And the second block says physical facility with nature. And for animals, we can see that this is necessary and largely adequate. If you feel that not adequate, then certainly not adequate for a human being. And for human being, this is not adequate, right? I hope all of us are able to see this. Now what happens next? Although we have recognized the need for relationship, we'll see that we get into arguments, opposition and fights, even in the family, with close friends, with colleagues at work, in the marketplace. Does it happen? What do you think? Now just look at your workplace. Does it happen or not? Now just ask yourself, at your workplace, do you want to have the feeling of opposition with anybody naturally? Do you want to feel opposed to anybody naturally? And I think all of us can see that no, we don't want to feel opposed. But do we feel opposed? Do we have a feeling of opposition with the other? Many times, you can see that so many issues keep on cropping up in the organizations because there is a feeling of opposition. And in fact, many a times the department invests much of its time, solving issues of relationship. In fact, if there is harmony in the relationship among all the faculty who are working in the department, the productivity, efficiency, effectiveness will be of a different order. So you can see that we naturally accept to have the feeling of relationship, but still we are not able to continue with this. So we get into arguments, we get into opposition, many times fight also, right? In the families, with the close friends, with colleagues at work, in the marketplace. And if you open the TV channel, the news channel, you can see almost 80% of the news is filled up with this, right? Issues of opposition, issues of fights. And what happens then? If you look at your family, every time you have a fight, you want to resolve it. You don't want to continue with this naturally, isn't it? So in the family, if there is a fight, if there is a quarrel, if there is something awkward happening in the family, you don't want to continue with this. And many times you go to the other, say sorry, accept your mistakes also, try to patch up, promise not to do this again, right? If you're not doing this, it's still worse, right? But if you're even doing this, we'll see that in spite of all this effort, a fight takes place once again. And this keeps on happening almost every 3 days, 4 days, or almost every week, isn't it? If not happening, very nice, very nice. But if it is happening, it's something to be understood why it is happening. So we'll see that we want the other to improve in the family, and the other also wants us to improve. Right, there are some hands raised. Maybe there are some reflections on this. So let me, Dr. Ganga Guru. I am sorry, Dr. Gyan Guru. Dr. Gyan Guru. You can speak, sir. Dr. Mujib. Dr. Sahaya. You can unmute yourself and speak, sir. This has a facility that every participant can unmute oneself and speak. Okay, Dr. Mujib.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. Can you hear me, sir?
Yes, sir. I can hear you clearly.
Yeah, I am from Cochin University. The talk was very nice. But for a depending on persons, the perceptions are different. So that is what I'm thinking, that for each person, that some person's happiness depends on their position, some their wealth, some with the relationship, or overall the entire system depends on the relationship. So that is what we are giving the talk.
So something has to be done at the level of perception, isn't it? If the perception is wrong,
Sir,
if our natural acceptance for relationship, problems keep on cropping up.
Yes, we need to give some variables for perceptions.
Yeah, certainly, sir. Certainly. This is something that we are going to address now.
Yes, sir. Okay, sir.
Okay, sir. Dr. Sahai. Okay, Dr. Jeeva Malar. Dr. Mahesh, Dr. Jayashree,
this is Dr. Mahesh. How do we ensure that fights don't take place?
Yes, this is what we are going to discuss now, sir.
Right. Okay, we'll listen to that. Thank you.
Hello.
Hello, ma'am.
This is Dr. Jayashree here.
Yes, ma'am.
Sir, actually, when we were talking of fulfillment of relationship and physical facility, a basic level of physical facility is required to be happy.
Yes.
And the absence of that is not. However good the relationships are, the absence of the physical facility is always going to create problems in any sort of relationships. Yes. So then how could we actually differentiate? Are we going towards accumulating physical facility, or are we going towards accumulating, strengthening our relationship?
So we can see very clearly that relationship is also required in addition to physical facility. So we are not negating physical facility. Physical facility is of course required. We all had our breakfast. We are sitting comfortably in our room, right? We are using our gadgets so that we are able to communicate. So we need this physical facility. But we can see that this is not complete. This is necessary, but not complete, not adequate. We need the relationship also.
Okay.
Right? And
okay,
whether we have to make a program for accumulating physical facility or something else, this is something that we will explore further.
Okay.
What program do I have to make for physical facility? Dr. Jeeva Malar, your voice is not very clear, sir.
Hello, sir. This is Sahai Arulbedi.
Hello, ma'am.
Hello.
Yes, ma'am.
Sir, are you able to hear me?
Yes, ma'am, clearly.
Yes, sir. Sir, for maintaining good relationship, actually we need some compromisation. Always we need to go with compromise. If we maintain that, certainly our relationship will be good, both at working place and at our home.
Okay. So you feel that compromises are necessary, right?
Yes, of course, to a certain level. If everyone is having compromises, automatically there won't be any fight.
Yeah. In fact, if you look at this, ma'am, we'll address this also. We have a feeling of compromising, right? Only when there is a feeling of loss in, somewhere a feeling of loss is involved. So when we have the understanding of relationship, then there is no feeling of compromise. Rather, we try to complement the other, by giving space to the other. So the feeling of compromise comes only when there is something lacking, in the understanding of the relationship. That's why you feel like compromising. And that's why you can see that with that feeling of compromise, you do not feel happy. You feel somewhat suppressed, somewhat depressed. And this does not ensure happiness also. So in place of compromise, what we really need to do, we'll talk about it. What could be the right alternative to compromise?
Okay.
Yes, fine, ma'am?
Yes, sir. Thank you, sir.
Okay, Dr. Menka. Dr. Nathan.
Hello.
Hello, sir.
I'm Dr. Nathan.
Yeah.
Actually, not to maintain the relationship, I think everyone is concerned about the ego. When we leave the ego, then there is a continuity in the relationship. This is my perception. Is it okay,
yes,
sir?
Yes. So, what you are trying to say that something else is required to maintain good relationships. Even if you feel concerned about relationship, you know, the relationships are not going to be harmonious. So something else is required. So somebody talked about changing the perspective. Somebody, like you are saying about, you know, this ego issue, right? So whether to pamper the ego of the other or to compromise with the ego of the other or to, you know, just, you know, leave the other, what to be done. So these are certain issues that we keep on thinking on. And if you look at this, no, whenever there is some issue in relationship, these occupy our thoughts and we keep on thinking them for, you know, hours together. Right, sir? So we'll address this, that in addition to these two, what else is required? In addition to these two, what else is required? We'll try to address it.
Okay, sir. Thank you.
Okay, so let me go ahead. There are some more hands raised. So as we go along, maybe your questions are naturally addressed. If not, we'll try to take them up, you know, further. So just find out whether this is happening and are incidences of reaction, not speaking to the other, arguments, deviates, even divorces sometimes increasing or decreasing today. If you look at the divorces, you know, that are taking place, they are going up. In fact, the nations which are called developed, right, which have much more wealth than our nation, you know, the divorce rates are much more higher. As per the data that I could get on Google, the divorce rate in our country is between 2-3%, while the divorce rate in the West, in Europe, is above 50%, nearing about 52-53%. Similarly, in US, above 50%. In Japan, above 50%, right? In fact, for Japan, I got a news that people are now fearing marriage there. They are fearing getting into conjugal relationships. So you can see that education is also going up, facilities are also going up, but again, these issues are also going up, you know, incidences of reaction, not speaking to the other. So explore your close relationships in the family, with friends, in the workplace, in the society, and find out whether this is happening or not. So what is the basic problem? In fact, through your interactions just that we had just now, we are able to see that something else needs to be addressed. Even if you feel concerned about the other, we try to ensure good relationship with the other, but something else is required to be done. So we'll try to explore into this, what else is required. So in spite of our acceptance for relationship, why is it happening? So there are three possibilities which are written here. You know? One is we want to live in relationship, that is harmony with the others. So let us check our perspective about relationship. The second would be we want to live in opposition with others. And the third thing is we believe living has to be necessarily in opposition with others. That is, there is struggle for survival and only the fittest can survive, right? This is a common notion that has become prevalent today. And in fact, education has worked a lot to spread this kind of notion. And let us find out where we feel happy, you know, living this way. Struggling for survival, proving ourselves to be the fittest with the other. So what do you think about the first one? Let us have your opinion on this. So just try to think over it. You know? So as we said earlier also, none of us wants to live in, you know, opposition. We naturally want to live in relationship. But what happens, there is some assumption in us. And that they struggle for survival and only the fittest can survive, right? So just try to explore this. Let us find out your opinion on this. Have you assumed that they struggle for survival and only the fittest can survive? In the meantime, I can take some more questions. Dr. Menka could not speak. Dr. Rajesh could not speak. Okay. Dr. Gopi.
Hello.
Yes, sir.
Good morning, sir. This is Rajesh from King's College of Engineering, Tanjore, Tamil Nadu. Sir, your session was really good. So what I feel is that the expectations in relationships, mm-hmm. when the expectations is not fulfilled, that may lead to fights and all those things, misunderstandings, everything. So better when you have more expectations at the same time, we should also have a mentality to for more adjustments too.
Yeah, so two issues you mentioned. One is the expectation and the other is adjustment. So we need to understand what expectations are there in the relationship, which are naturally acceptable to each one of us, and going by which we can have fulfilling relationships. So we need to understand those expectations which can ensure mutual fulfillment. And whether you want to adjust with the other or whether you want to have fulfilling relations with the other. See, when we do not, we are not able to have fulfilling relationships, then we try to adjust with the other, right? But yes, this sir. Is certainly not acceptable naturally, adjusting with somebody else. Adjusting would mean that it is not acceptable naturally, but you do not have a way out, So you try to adjust. But the better would be, we are able to understand each other, we are able to ensure harmonious relationship with each other, so that there is no need for adjustment, isn't it?
Yes, sir.
So that is the way to go forward, So we are going to talk about it.
Sure, sir.
Hello, sir. Can you hello? Yes, sir, can you hear me?
Yes, ma'am.
Sir, can you hear me, sir?
Yes, ma'am. Yes, ma'am. Clearly.
I am Dr. Menaka. Sir, what I feel is the basic love for human beings is not at all present nowadays. Though we call ourselves as highly educated people, when it comes to accept the other person, we fail a lot. So I think that the love, that nice feeling of a human being is missing in our generation. And I don't know how we are going to impart this basic love to others. There lies the challenge of these human values. So I think if we train people to love everyone without any, without conditions, unconditional love, only that will connect all the people, and thereby we can solve all these issues.
Nice, ma'am. We are going to discuss it in detail. So I hope you are going to be there in all the sessions.
Yes, sir. Sure, sir.
Okay. Nice, ma'am. We are going to discuss
this.
Yes, sir. And if you look at this, the feeling of love, this assumption about struggle for survival, the two cannot go together. When you have the feeling of struggling for survival, how can you love the other? And when you have a feeling of love for the other, how can you struggle with the other? So unknowingly, this kind of assumption has got embedded in the education today, that they struggle for survival, there's cutthroat competition and so many things. And you can see that children of age of 5 or 6 years get depressed because of this kind of feeling. Try to impose this kind of assumption on the child.
Nicely said,
ma'am, we need to understand the feeling of love.
Unless
we understand the feeling of love, we are not going to have it naturally enough.
Yes, sir. Actually, that is missing even in our professional setup.
Certainly, ma'am. In fact,
lot of professional jealousy. Lot of professional jealousy is there. Cutthroat professionalism is there. So all these have to be rooted out.
Yeah. And we are not able to see that out of all this, what we are gaining. We might gain physical facility, but the happiness is missing.
Yes, sir. That's it.
Exactly. Nice.
Okay, sir. Thank you, sir.
Thank you, ma'am. Okay. Dr. Gopi wants to say something.
Well, from my perspective, I feel that if we are content with our desire, hope we will be happy, sir.
Yeah. So what is contentment? And how can our desire be
fixing the desire based on the income what we get or whatever we get as input. If we fix the desire, I think we will be happy and we can make even family members happy, sir. Making them understand what is the input we get for which we live.
So basically, sir, again, I'll say that we need to understand our desires. That desires, fulfilling which we are going to ensure happiness within ourselves and happiness with the other. Otherwise, just trying to force ourselves to feel contented will ultimately lead to adjustment or compromise or certain things which is not acceptable naturally. So we need to understand what desires are naturally acceptable to us, fulfilling which we can have this happiness in continuity. We are going to talk about it, sir.
Moreover, with today's micro family, we have forgot ourselves with all the old traditional families with macro families.
Yeah.
With all my fathers and brothers, sisters.
Yeah, in fact, three generations living together was a good tradition that was there, and that is getting slowly lost. And
this has even raised
the need for physical facility in the family and given so many problems. Yeah, that is there, sir.
Yes, sir. Thank you, sir.
Nice, sir. We are going to talk about the solution part of it.
Yes, sir. Thank you, sir.
So nice. So a sincere appraisal is made here that we are somewhat assuming that they struggle for survival and only the fittest can survive. Now, let me ask a simple question to reflect upon this, right? So let us say there is a room in which there is food enough only for one person. One person is strong and the other is weak. Who will get the food? What do you think? There is food sufficient for only one person. There are two persons in the room, right? One is strong, the other is weak. So a general answer would be the stronger person would get the food, isn't it? Right? But if you look at the same scenario in which the stronger person is the mother and the weaker person is the child, then who will get the food? Naturally, the child will get the food. Now, what has happened here? Now, there is a feeling of relationship here. The mother will feed the child first, even to the fullest of the stomach, right? And then only eat, because there is a feeling of relationship here. So whenever there is a feeling of relationship, we do not struggle to survive. Rather, we help the other to survive. We let the other live first and then try to live when there is a feeling of relationship. But when there is no feeling of relationship, we obstruct the living of the other to make ourselves live. In a family, if you see, there are two brothers and they have a feeling of relationship, and the elder brother gets a job, he invests all his mind, body, wealth, to help the younger brother, come to a better state, right? Study or get on a job. Now, there is no struggle for survival here, but rather there is a feeling of relationship here. So whenever there is a feeling of relationship, there is no struggle for survival. But unknowingly, we have to come to assume this in our education. And somewhat this has become a part and parcel of our thought process. So what is our present perspective? Which view do we promote? Just try to reflect on this at home, in the family, in the schools and colleges, in the society, right? And is it naturally acceptable to us? So we'll see that in addition to relationship, another thing that is required in our life is right understanding. So as you saw that the perception of the other has to be worked on, right? One has to understand the other. One has to develop the understanding in the mutual relationship. So right understanding is also necessary for human being. So for fulfillment in relationship, it's necessary to have right understanding about relationship. Unless we have the right understanding about relationship, even though we make a very sincere effort in the relationship, we feel tired. We feel unhappy, depressed many times. We try for fulfilling the other, making the other happy for days together. But when we are not able to see the continuity of it, we start feeling tired, depressed, and many times then we withdraw. And it's something that may happen in any relationship, isn't it? So there's something called right understanding, which is required. And we'll explore into this in detail. In fact, in the whole workshop, we are going to explore about the right understanding, right? How to understand the things rightly, how to understand the things as they are. But we can see clearly that this is another need of the human being. And with right understanding only, we have the clarity about the relationship with the human being. We are able to fulfill the relationship. And we also have the clarity about how much physical facility we need, isn't it? So, in fact, a common problem in the relationship is that the other does not understand you. Dusra mujhe samajh nahi paata. You ask yourself, are you able to understand yourself? You are complaining about the other, that the other is not able to understand you. Are you able to understand yourself? And see what answer do you get. So many times we have complaints regarding the other in the relationship, but we are not clear about ourselves, right? So unless I understand myself, how can I understand the other? And the same thing holds true for the other. So when we start discussing the right understanding, we'll start discussing from human being, how to understand the human being. So, and second thing, with right understanding only, we are able to make out what physical facility you need, how much do we require, in what way do we have to fulfill this by interacting with the nature, and so on. So for a human being, we can see that three kinds of things are required: right understanding in the self, relationship with human being, and physical facility with the rest of nature, right? So just find out, try to introspect and see whether all three are required or we can remove something from here. Right? Is something redundant here? Can it be that only right understanding is there, physical facility is there, but no relationship? Or right understanding is there, relationship is there, but no physical facility? And if you are able to ensure all the three, then what else is required? Just try to reflect on this. Try to think over this. That if you are able to ensure all the three in your life, you just try to see what all imaginations you have within you, right? And fulfilling, trying to ensure happiness in your imagination is something else that you will try to imagine about. And just find out whether we are working for all the three. And if all three are required, then what will be the priority? And priority means that working on the higher priority makes it easier to deal with the lower priority. So let me again have your reflection here. So just try to see what would be the first priority, what would be the second priority, and what would be the third priority. Pause a little bit and reflect on this and then only give your opinion. In the meantime, if there are some hands raised, I can take questions. Mr. Karthik, I have a request that once you have been responded to, please lower your hands, you know, because some hands are still raised while we have discussed. Yeah, Mr. Karthik, you have any question?
Yes, sir. This is Karthik from Modified Institute of Technology in Appatanam, Tamil Nadu. In your point of view, what is the main reason the generation grow up like, in vice versa, the human values will decrease?
Sir, your voice little got cut off. What is the main reason?
If the generations grown up, but the human values will decrease based on relationship.
Sir, it so happens, no, that in education, we have not given the right priority to values, right? Most of the content that we are teaching today, right from primary education, is only focused on skills, and gathering more and more information about everything outside, but nothing for inside, right? And then trying to learn a skill to earn more and more physical facility. Since childhood, we are training the child to think that money is everything, isn't it?
Okay.
Why to go for education? To get a job. What kind of job? To get maximum pay. How much? Anything is fine. So this kind of mindset we are creating through education. We have been creating, right? So education has been at fault for sure. The child is also not able to get the right kind of inculcation in the family through parents. If the parents would have the right understanding, they would have been able to give the right kind of inculcation in the child, but that is also missing. And if you look at the surrounding, the what is happening in the surrounding, then again something otherwise is happening in the surrounding. So neither education has provision for it, nor the society has provision for it, nor the child is able to get the same thing in the family. See, the child was a very innocent child in the beginning, right? And as he grows, then they turn into such kinds of people whom we see as problems for the society, isn't it? So ultimately, we have to see that how education can be set right, because ultimately this kind of input has to go into education. And why only to go for value education? Why not make every course value based, isn't it?
Okay.
Why to talk about value in one course and invaluable things in the other course? Why not make every course value-based? Invaluable would mean that ultimately whatever input we are giving has to have a foundation on the values, isn't it?
Yes, sir.
Okay. Dr. Paul Raj?
Yeah, very good afternoon, sir. This is Dr. Paul Raj from SRM TRP Engineering College.
Yeah, good afternoon, sir.
So my question is, how to we balance for good and opposite people, whether it is in our family relationship or in our working place?
So balancing means that in the relationship, you are able to fulfill yourself as well as you are able to fulfill the other, isn't it? Hello. Yeah. So balancing means in relationship, balancing means that you are able to fulfill yourself as well as fulfill the other.
Fulfill,
Pardon, sir?
Yeah, I want to fulfill the both sides. How
yeah,
can
yeah.
we do
this? Yeah, this is the way, sir. This is the way that we are discussing. In fact, in the next slide, I'm going to address it.
Okay, sir. Okay. Your presentation is very informative and useful for all level of administrative people and coordinators, sir. Thank you.
Okay. Nice, sir. So nice, you know, most of us are able to see that right understanding comes at the first priority, relationship comes at the second priority, and physical facilities come only at the third priority. Very nice, you know. If it appears otherwise, you know, then do reflect back on this. Do reflect back on this, right? So nice if you are able to see this very clearly. So right understanding comes at the first priority, and a relationship comes at the second priority, and physical facility comes at the third priority. Now with right understanding in the self only, I am able to ensure those feelings in me, you know, which can ensure mutual happiness, like trust, you know, respect. We'll discuss about these feelings in detail, try to understand them. So unless I understand what is trust, unless I understand what is respect, right? Even though I expect trust, expect respect in the relationship, but I'm not able to ensure the same in me. And I keep on borrowing this from others. Now the other is also not having this understanding, and the other is also borrowing from you. And it so happens in the relationship to keep on borrowing, you know, feelings from the other in place of sharing our feelings. And you know, in place of mutual happiness, what results is mutual unhappiness. So when we have the right understanding in the self, then only we are able to ensure these feelings in the relationship. And when we go to live with the other, interact with the other, then we are able to ensure mutual happiness. Similarly, with right understanding the self only, we are able to make out what physical facility we require, how much do we require, and how to fulfill it with the rest of nature. For example, if I require food, what can be termed as food? This is to be understood. Now you see this kind of havoc, this pandemic that has spread, you know, it is being said that this has come from some wrong kind of food, right? Now, if with the whole history of civilization of mankind, if you are not able to understand food, then something is very, very basically wrong with our education, right? So you need to understand what is food, you know, from where to get food, how to get food. Now, if I am cultivating something on the soil, then I also have to ensure that the soil is able to produce the next year also. So I have to ensure that the soil also gets enriched when I'm cultivating, right? Similarly with every aspect of nature, if I'm interacting with the nature, trying to fulfill my physical facility, need for physical facility, then I have to ensure that it has to be mutually prosperous. So with right understanding only, I'm able to ensure mutual prosperity, prosperity for my family as well as prosperity for the rest of nature. On the other hand, if one is ignorant about right understanding, one is ignorant about relationship and just working for physical facility, trying to accumulate as much as possible, right? Then what happens in the self, if you see, we have all those anxieties, depressions, you know, sorrows, griefs, complaints, grudges. We can see all this, right? And with that, when we interact with the other, with lots of grudges and complaints within us, you know, anxieties within us, then we make the other unhappy. We are unhappy within, and we are making the other also unhappy. Similarly, with lack of right understanding, since we have not addressed this properly, we are not able to understand what is food, what is clothes, what is shelter, you know? How much do I need, how to fulfill this, right? And then I feel deprived within myself. Even though I have accumulated a lot, you know, I might have lakhs of crores of rupees, but if I do not have the right understanding in myself, then I'm not able to make out that this much is enough. And if I'm not able to make out that this much is enough, then I feel deprived within. And when I feel deprived within, I exploit the other, right? I exploit the human being as well as the rest of nature. So mutual deprivation, mutual exploitation, this is something to be seen. So human consciousness would mean ensuring all the three, right? Understanding in the self, relationship with human being, physical facility with the rest of nature. And the test of ensuring all the three is mutual happiness and mutual prosperity, right? So whether I have been able to ensure mutual happiness, ensure human consciousness in me or not, is going to be tested in my interactions with the human, with the rest of nature. So if you are living with all the three, that is right understanding, relationship, and physical facility, and that in that priority order, right, then we are living with human consciousness. Human being can be fulfilled and be happy and prosperous on the basis of these three only. On the other hand, if one is only aspiring for physical facility, working for it day and night, right, ignoring their understanding, ignoring the relationships, then this is living like an animal. So this is termed as animal consciousness. So if our living is only for physical facility, then we are living with animal consciousness. And animals live only for physical facility and can be fulfilled by that. Human being cannot be fulfilled on the basis of physical facility alone. So you can see that animals living with animal consciousness are in harmony. And this is fine, no problem. In a forest, animals are living with animal consciousness, and this is fine. You know, the forest is continuing. Human being living with human consciousness is also fine. We will be in harmony. If the society is filled up with people who have this human consciousness, then we are going to be in harmony. The society will, you know, continue. But when human being living with animal consciousness is there, then there is a, you know, problem. Because then we are in disharmony. And this is the problem. Now all the problems in the society you can see are, is basically because of human being living with animal consciousness. You know? All the problems that you can see in the society today. So in the society we can observe that there are two categories of human beings. One category is people who are lacking physical facility and they are unhappy and deprived. And the second category is those who are having physical facility and still they are unhappy and deprived. And if you look at the current education, at most what it is bringing people from 1 to 2. People who are lacking physical facility are going to have physical facility. But again, not for all. You know? Again, not for all, right? But the common denominator is being unhappy, being deprived. Now, what we really want to be is this. We want to have the physical facility. At the same time, we want to be happy and prosperous, isn't it? So find out where we are now at 1, 2, or 3. And where do we want to be? So again, you know, just pause over this, think over this, and we'll take your reflection on this. So where do we want to reach? You want to have physical facility but feel unhappy and deprived? You want to lack physical facility and feel unhappy and deprived? Or you want to have physical facility at the same time feel happy and prosperous? Okay, in the meantime, I can take the opinion of Dr. Tamil Selvi.
Sir, good afternoon, sir. This is Tamil Selvi, Dr. Tamil Selvi from National University of Kovilpatti, sir.
Yes, ma'am.
Sir, actually, we have almost all people have all the physical facilities and the relationships, sir. But this won't give the satisfaction, the inner satisfaction, they will not get it. So,
yeah. For they that, want to be understanding is required. Yeah.
Sir?
For that, right understanding is required.
Yes, sir. Right understanding as well as the self-realization, sir. That is also very much required, sir. Self-realization. Who am I and yes. What I want to do? What is the purpose of life? So that analysis is required, sir, to have yes. A peacefulness in the mind. Sir.
Right, ma'am. So this right understanding encompasses this also, the self-realization.
Yes, sir.
So I am able to understand the whole reality as it is, everything as it is. You know? This is yes, the meaning of right yes. Understanding.
Yes, sir.
Right, ma'am.
Thank you, sir.
So nice, you know. Almost all of you are able to see that you want to have physical facility at the same time. You want to feel happy and prosperous. If not, then try to reflect back on this. Try to reflect back on this. Now there is a book by this Susan George, you know, and the book says that by the time we finish reading this book, 400 people would have died of hunger or disease caused by hunger. And contrary to the popular opinion, malnutrition and starvation are not the result of overpopulation, of poor climate or lack of cultivable land, but rather the other half is dying because the first half is not right utilizing the resources. So hunger is not a scourge, but a scandal. So you can have so many data, you know. There's another data from this UN. That of the 4.2 billion tons of food produced, more than 1 billion tons of food is lost or wasted every year. This is a UN-backed report. So the global food production is 6 times the requirement, and global food wastage is 1/3 of the production. So wastage is enough to feed 1,300 crore people. And if you look at the population that was there in 2011, this was something around 700 crore people. Right? So you can see that, you know, the amount of food that is being wasted is double the need, almost double the need. right? So if this is not wasted, then the population can be fed very easily. So we have to reflect on this, that have we really understood what right utilization is? And certainly this is not a question of production. This is a question of distribution. There is production, but it is not going to into the right place. And why is distribution faulty? Because there is a lack of feeling of relationship. If somebody is dying of hunger and we are consuming more than what we need, then there is an issue of relationship here. It is being said that in England, you know, most of the children are obese, and obesity is also becoming a problem in our cities, in metro cities, right? So we are consuming much more than our body requires, right? And somebody is dying of hunger. So certainly there is no dearth of food. What is lacking is the feeling of relationship. We are not able to share with the other. And certainly this issue of relationship is going to be resolved only through right understanding. And this is going to be ensured only through education, right? So this transformation is required from this kind of scenario, something on the bottom side where we are just trying to accumulate physical facility. We need to move to the complete paradigm of human consciousness. Now this transformation is desirable. But again, we'll take your reflection on this. What do you think? Is this desirable or not? In the meantime, let me take Dr. Femina. Dr. Femina.
Yes, sir. Good morning, sir. Good
morning, ma'am. Yes, ma'am.
Sir, you said that nowadays there is a lack of love. As Dr. Menaka madam said, there is a lack of love. And now the life has become commercial and selfishness has been involved more. So there is less bond between people. Between the people among the family itself. So if one needs a human relationship, if they start sacrificing or compromising, the person is taken for granted and it continues. So if a person is doing that in one family or in one environment, that is the scenario that person has to continue it for the sake of the working environment or for the family. Or wherever they may be.
Okay, ma'am, I could get your question to some extent because your voice was breaking, but let me explain a bit here. I will talk about relationship in detail.
Yes.
That ultimately, what is needed is not compromising or sacrificing. What is needed is right understanding. So with right understanding, we are able to understand the other. With right understanding, we are able to understand the expectations of the other, which are naturally acceptable. Right? And then when we go to interact with the other, it is not a kind of loss to ourselves, right? So when I have this right understanding in myself, you know, then there is no feeling of sacrificing, but rather we are able to make the right program with the other. So what we can do, ma'am, we'll discuss this in much more detail. And today evening, your voice was breaking a little bit. Today evening, when you come, then do bring up this question, if not addressed, and then we'll discuss in detail.
Okay.
Nice. So all of us are almost able to see that, yes, this is desirable, right? And we have to find out whether we are making effort for it, and do we need to make effort for it. So we'll explore into this effort required for the transformation to holistic development. So the role of education sanskar, if you see, is to ensure this transformation, right? So the role of education sanskar is to enable this transformation by way of ensuring the development of the competence to live with definite with human consciousness and with definite human conduct. And for this, it has to ensure right understanding in every child, the capacity to live in relationship with other human being, and the capacity to identify the need of physical facility and the skills and practice for sustainable production of more than what is required. Right? We'll discuss about all this in detail so that one has the feeling of prosperity. So if you look at the current state, the first one is missing. We are not giving any course which can ensure right understanding in the child. The capacity to live in relationship with other also is not being addressed. This is also missing. In terms of physical facility also, if you see, the identification of the need of physical facility is missing. Nowhere we are talking about how much is the need, right? And the willingness to produce by way of labor is also missing. The students do not develop a mindset of producing through labor, but rather the core feeling that is generated is to accumulate more and more, consume more and more, right? Rather than going for production also. So most of the problems we see around us are really only the symptoms of the human beings not living with human consciousness. So the basic effort is required to ensure human consciousness through human education. So when we have this human education, then this can ensure human consciousness so that we are able to live with human values and our conduct can be humane, so that with a humane character, we can interact in the society. And ultimately, this will result in a humane tradition. So we'll talk about all this. So many words are coming here. We'll talk about all this, right? So it will result in a human tradition in which the human goal is fulfilled for all generation after generation. But this is certainly desirable. We are able to see that generation after generation, things are becoming worse. You know? Whether this planet is going to survive or not is also being questioned, the way we are moving ahead, right? So understanding of harmony, you know, and what all it encompasses, we'll talk about it. So harmony in the human being, harmony in the family, harmony in the society, harmony in the nature and existence. These are the levels of our living. We live at four levels: human being, family, society, nature, or existence. When we have this understanding of harmony, then we have the values embedded in us, right? And then they guide our living, and then our living is also in harmony. And when we have the skills guided by values in this way, then we have mutual happiness, mutual prosperity in our living. And this is something that we are aspiring for, isn't it? So this understanding part is the education part. So education means basically ensuring this right understanding. So as I mentioned, there are four levels of our living, you know, human being, family, society, nature, existence. And we need to understand the harmony at every level. And when we have this understanding, then we go to live also with, you know, harmony in, at all these levels. So in relationships, you are able to ensure the mutual happiness. With physical facility, you are able to ensure the mutual prosperity. So the living part is something called a sanskar, the inculcation part, right? And the understanding part is here, education. And we need to understand both in the education. Now, when you extend this, then we see that when you have the right understanding in the self at all levels, then we are able to ensure justice in relationship. We'll discuss what justice means. And we'll also discuss what feelings ensure justice in the relationship. So when we have this competence slowly, gradually, by ensuring that understanding in us, then we are able to ensure justice not only in our family, but we are able to participate in the world family with a feeling of justice. And this mutual happiness that is started from one-to-one interaction becomes a pillar of undivided society. Similarly, with the right understanding here, we are able to participate in the larger order.